So now I invite Milind Chaudhary to speak to us about the cases where nothing but an Ilizarov will do. There are multiple areas where this is possible, you know, this is true, but we'll get his opinion for a particular region because there's, you know, this is a relatively limited time in terms of the program that we have, right? So, Milind, for
thank you.
The knee and ankle.
Thank you, Mangal. Can't say no to Mangal, can't say no to BOS. Thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be back to my alma mater, Cooper Hospital, after, I think, 33 years. I think I had the best time of my residency career at Cooper, what with Dr. AJ Thakur as my, yes, and my motorbike and so many good things. So thank you for inviting me. This is really, it's a transformation, but this is really the, and thank you, Mangal, for letting me speak on the really difficult problems in non-unions where apparently nothing else will work. So it's going to be a bit of a difference, you know, the stark contrast between Sanjay and me, him clean-shaven, me with my unruly hair, him with his celebrity charisma, and me with my middle-of-the-country Hicktown practice where we do non-glamorous surgeries like Ilizarov. So bear with me, but hope to prove to you how really very few things are likely to work in the cases that I will show. So this is a neurologist who's in training. He's had this supracondylar fracture. He's been treated five different surgeons. One surgery has been performed in Russia in the city of Kazan, where he's actually doing his post-graduation. And this is this huge chunk of cement sitting there. It's obviously infected, very small fragment. You can see the coronal almost coronal orientation of his non-union. Multiple holes, you can see all of his previous surgeries, all the plates, all the wonderful locking plates have wreaked havoc, and he's got a bit of shortening as well. So really, when we are left with this, we really don't have too much choice but to offer him a complete treatment and ensure that he gets the result this time around. He's a budding young neurologist. His career is at stake, and he has to go back to finish his graduation. So what we chose to do was to resect, remove the cement, debride him again, make sure that the infection is controlled. Fortunately, it was not very, very virulent, not pouring pus or stuff. And then the thing that I want to show you is when you have a non-union surface, you see the first rule, regardless of whether you're treating with a nail or a plate, you need to achieve compression for stability. So when you try to achieve stability in such a... It's okay, sorry. When you try to give compression, the longitudinal compression will, the longitudinal compression will only serve to create more shortening. Whereas what we need to achieve is achieve compression perpendicular, just like your interfragmentary screw, and do that with the external fixator. So you can do that with the Ilizarov, with the help of hinges, which you stack up. You stack up washers so that the distal fragment will move a little anteriorly, a little by little, once in every once in 4 days or once every day, depending upon the amount of gap. Or when you have a TSF fixator, which is the the original computer software controlled fixator, you can set up the compression to occur from posterior to anterior. And that's how we did it. He also got a lengthening at the proximal end. And in 7 months' time, he's united. He's going to recover his knee range of motion. He writes to me from time to time. He's got 60 degrees already. He's fine, he's weight bearing. But that's the thing to remember. When you have oblique surfaces, you need to give compression side to side, horizontal compression or compression like an interfragmentary screw with whatever technology you can use. This is a young lad, also from the hinterlands. He's got this lateral condyle non-union with previous infection. He's got 7 centimeters of shortening and 7 centimeters shortening. This is completely mobile and previously infected. So we can't adventure to do internal fixation again because you can burn your fingers. Are we doing fine? Sorry, thanks a lot, sorry. So this is a scanogram which shows the significant amount of shortening. So how do we treat this? You know, you can choose to ignore the shortening. You can just do bone grafting. You can do internal fixation. If you're very lucky, you can get away with it. So we have a classification of infection, you know, in non-unions. It's published in IJO last April. So how do you decide when is internal fixation safe in the presence of infection? So you grade the severity of infection. So it's about the skin, the soft tissues, the sinuses, the amount of discharge, the presence of, and the quantity and the size of the sequestrae, the quantum of the discharge, the kind of surgeries that were done in the past, etc. It's there in IGO. So you could get away or you may not get away with internal fixation. So what we chose to perform is, first let's focus on the slides on the right. The fragment is osteoporotic, so you can't get a hold of it with half pins because they'll just pull through. So this is a technique we use from time to time. This is going to be a selection of very complex cases, so bear with me. These are not very standard techniques. We use some 5 or 6 wires and in different directions. They are fixed to a half ring, which is carbon fiber, so you can't see it. And that ring is translated very, very gradually from lateral to medial. Of course, I went down and debrided. I opened it up. I removed all the fibrous tissue and all that. And I found that the infection was quiescent. So I did put in some graft. And we gradually not only translated it, but also sort of tilted it to come back here. Did a proximal corticotomy, lengthened it 7 centimeters. Whenever you're faced with a very distal juxta articular non-union, you need to cross the joint. So one joint below at least. So we also fixed the tibia like so. And fortunately for him, he's ended up with a union and completely equal leg lengths. So when you have thin fragments, when you need to move from side to side, using a lot of wires can help you solve these problems. Commoner are upper end of the tibia problems. This is strictly a delayed presentation, not a non-union. What do you do when you have not only a very small fragment, which is hard to fix, but also a lot of soft tissue loss? So then you span it with the Ilizarov. You span the... These fixators may not give the adequate stability. So what we do in such circumstances, there is some shortening. You don't know how much bone you're going to lose and stuff like that. So not only is our target soft tissue cover, but also union and equal lengths, no infection, no deformity. So we have to try and achieve all of that. So in the we go across, and in the first stage, we do not fix the small fragment at all. We do whatever is necessary. Debride, put in cement beads, put in a block, whatever. And then this is a medial gastroc flap. And then once that is done, once he's out of his negative nitrogen balance, then you perform the corticotomy at a distal end, not before that. Because if you don't want to burden him, his system. And then thereafter, you can still see that the proximal fragment is not fixed. And so now, later on, when things are going well, that's when you fix his proximal fragment with thin wires, 3, 4 of them, depending. And the fixator on the femur stays on, it aids you, and then you get a good handle on the proximal fragment, and then you're in business and things are under control. And you can have him with almost equal leg lengths, no infection, no deformity, and reasonably good function. So this is a 62-year-old, 8-week injury, fracture dislocation. The upper tibia is dislocated posteriorly and medially. He's got active pulmonary cox. Physician says, don't go down, don't open him. So then what do we need to do? We need to leave a minimum footprint on his physiology and yet do something for him. So obviously, we are not looking at a primary arthrodesis. So we are trying to not just salvage, we are trying to get the best possible. So how do we do this? Again, unusual circumstances. So fix the femur, fix the tibia, there she comes. Couple of wires in this fragment, at the anterolateral part, the big chunk of the shaft and the medial area is fixed with regular fixation. And then you gradually relocate with these wires. If you can see these washes on the right, so simple mechanisms, cost you a couple of rupees each washer. And the orientation of the plane of the hinges are such that all the hinges must be parallel. Otherwise, this thing doesn't work. And then you add them. 1 a day, 2 a day, stuff like that. Low technology, but works, always works. Never give up on your patients, never give up on hard problems, because you can make it happen. and then it comes together, and then you are able to fix them all with a couple of wires and reasonably good alignment and function. And here he is with a couple of weeks after fixator removal. Now he's brought back his nephew for some other orthopedic problems, so he has about 110 degrees knee flexion, not more, but he's happy. He's got no problems. This is 10-year follow-up. What do you do in a case like this? This is a cop. He's not a celebrity. He's your man on the street. He's your average Joe. He's your average Johnny. And he's your average Rambhav. So he's got this non-union. He's operated. He's infected. He's got very poor skin over there. And you really need to scratch your brains what to do. You don't want to offer him arthrodesis. He doesn't want one. If you go down, very poor quality skin, if you try to put in any implants, first of all, there's no place to get a grip, and the skin's going to give way. So again, we have to seek recourse to some tried and tested principles. This case will highlight just one more of those. So what we do is we go above into the femur, of course. This we have seen. But what we do is we add on a dome osteotomy just below the site of the non-union. That's number one. That helps to correct the varus deformity, because unless the varus is corrected, it's going to continue to have these forces which will push up that fragment. And we fix this fragment with the help of, I think, 8, 9, or 10 wires placed in the direction of the fracture line. Again, fixed to a ring, you can see this. And we're going to gradually, very, very slowly, in tiny amounts, lift up this fragment to try and relocate it where it should sort of belong. It's a little iffy. It looks iffy and dicey, but, you know, close-up view shows. So this is something we learned with the TAO, the method of treating TAO. Again, non-celebrity disease. This is Sakharam smoking 40 BDs a day. But we learned these things. We can fix, we can do the medial transportation. So we can fix these fragments and get it up and not worry about the very poor quality of skin, like so. It's slowly coming up. The high tibial osteotomy is working, and then we test it. We loosen the connections. We make sure things are doing well. And here he is. It's united, though you see some, because of the sclerosis, you see some something. The slope is not 100% corrected. And I'm sorry, I forgot to include his photograph, but he's doing well. There's no skin problems. He's walking on it. He's got poor knee movement as of now, because this is only 1 year follow-up. He's got only about 30 degrees of range of motion. But he's united, he's got no pain, he can walk, he's resumed his duties as a cop. If there's any better solution, I would love to hear it, really. So, lower end of tibia again. Now, this is, I thank Dr. Modi for this, allowing me to treat this gentleman. He is very influential, right-hand man of ex-CM of Gujarat. He's a total knee. He's got a lower end tibia fracture. Celebrity. My two bit. So, of course, in the first stage, we did this, the regular stuff. We debride, put in a cement rod like so. He's got a really tiny fragment. So, very tiny fragment like so. And if you do the Ilizarov, or, you know, you can have difficulties. If you end up with a little procarvatum, see this problem with lower tibia, small fragments, even in, say, congenital pseudarthrosis of tibia, which is a congenital non-union. If you have procarvatum, that is, if you have an axis problem, especially procarvatum, it's going to refracture, and it's not going to heal up. So you have to really ensure that you have got rid of the deformities, which is difficult with small fragments. So you fix it with a TS. This, again, I did with a TSF, 3 or 4 wires. And we make sure that there's no procarvatum on the X-ray on the left, you see. And it's a bit of a task, because you can't see too well with the crisscrossing struts. But you have to create the program and ensure that you get, and of course you have to fix the foot. So here again, we go one joint below. So you have to get aid of fixation to the next fragment, fix the foot, and maybe you sacrifice range of motion in the ankle. Maybe they never started off with an ankle range of motion, but that's our day-to-day menu of infected non-unions. And here he is. He had liver failure, lots of problems, hemoglobin 7 g/cent, lots of problems like that. But, you know, he did manage well with the fixator. Fortunately, you can see there's no procarvatum, which is the bane of this treatment. And here he is, all healed up, with no deformities. For a few days, weeks, we keep him with the brace, and I know he's barely walking, but he did well eventually. So we are nearing the end, another lower end tibia fracture came to us, not a celebrity, came to us from very far. He was in septicemia, he was in shock. He was brought in an ambulance like this. He's got a very bad wound, previous infection. I have now got a big collection of these cases. You're doing a MIPPO, and the whole thing blows up. Your skin, soft tissue, everything blows up, and they are into septicemia. And it can happen if they're diabetics. So what we do in the first stage, it's a very bad wound. So you immediately put on an Ilizarov. The Ilizarov, don't do any fixation of the lower end. Just keep it like that. He's in ICU. We fixed him by the side of the ICU in about half an hour. He's got a foot frame, several wires. The wound starts getting better immediately. Couple of debridements. Then you do the necessary, add few, you know, your beads and stuff, and then take care of the soft tissues, improve the fixation if situation permits. Again, the lower end is not fixed. He gets better, he just gets a skin graft. That's it. Over a period of time, he recovers from, it takes him 6 weeks to recover, and then when things get better, that's when we fix the distal fragment with wires. It's a very small fragment. We can get in 2-3 wires, get in a carbon fiber ring, you can see, so you can visualize a little better. He's got a foot frame, of course. And then, you know, he starts walking. And it takes only 6 months, but he's fine. And believe it or not, he's even got 30 degrees range of motion in the ankle. He's absolutely fine. Brought his wife for a high tibial osteotomy. So, all right, I'll end with this. This is a gentleman in the heartland of India. He's an advisor to the local member of parliament. He gets brachial plexus injury, Montegia, other side. Shaft femur, one side, has got this very bad compound. I hope I'm not boring you too much, Jairam. And he's got this bad wound like this, completely open. So we put him in the Ilizarov. You know, we do the same things, fix above, debride him, do the VAC, do everything necessary, and then we say, hey, microvascular surgery is supposed to be better than Ilizarov. So let's go for microvascular surgery. And on the top, we have this, you know, big flap that we've taken, ALT, and at the bottom, in a disheartening 48 hours, it's all turned black on you. Remember a similar statement by my great teacher, Professor Baudekar, who said, I find that bone is not filled with red marrow, but black ingratitude at times. That's what Nonunions. Yeah. So black ingratitude, black marrow, ingratitude. Thank you, sir. May God rest his soul in peace. So what do? Then? You have these slivers of fragments floating around a failed microvascular. The gentleman who did it says, get it off his leg. Get it off his leg. Obviously, that's the easiest thing to do. The gentleman will have none of it at all. And he wants his leg to be preserved at any cost. He's already had a brachial plexus surgery, 3 other surgeries. So what do we do then? Thin slivers of fragments, again to our rescue, comes number one, patience, more patience, and a little ingenuity with simple things like wires fixing the small fragments at different places and make the chap walk. So he gets skin grafts, the wound stabilizes, make him walk. And with your permission, there is this whole big thing and a whole big industry around bone stimulation. Healing of unhealed bones using your BMPs, your platelets, your bone marrow concentrates, and it's getting pricier and pricier and pricier. It's like the stock market balloon. We don't know where it's going to burst. It's probably the Bitcoin. But you make these chaps walk. If they can walk on the fixator, believe you me, things can happen. And here he is with his own limb. It's completely healed up. I saw him again just 1 week ago. He's able to walk on it fairly well. There's some restriction of ankle motion, some restriction of knee motion. You can see he's had multiple problems, but he's a never-die spirit. And there he is. So with simple tools, a little perseverance and patience, you can do quite a bit. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Milind. So, questions? How many of you will consider or let not consider, I think. How many of you are comfortable using the Ilizarov? Okay, there's
thank you.
A small
thank you.
A small minority.
In indicated cases.
Yeah?
For us.
Question. Yeah. Can I'll start from Atul.
Milind, for the case with the proximal tibia, the COP, for the varus, where you did a dome osteotomy.
Yeah.
So in that case, is it possible you can do a percutaneous elevation of the fragment instead of doing gradual, you know, you said the skin was very bad. But if you can do a percutaneous window there, instead of doing, you know, multiple wires and gradually elevating it, is that possible to do in these small fragments? You put a periosteal elevator, elevate it, then fix it with the wire, rather than doing this, you know,
gradually.
Slowly.
Yeah, gradually. Rather than doing it gradually. Yeah, that's an option. Yeah, you're right. That's an option. But I would have created an acute gap. See, the fragment is sclerotic. The skin is very poor. It would give way. If I were to elevate it, the skin would give way and there would be a gap. Then I need a flap and stuff like that. It's a big problem. And then I can't fix. I have no certainty that the thing is going to work. That's the reason when you actually see it, then you realize you can't do it acutely. And it's all sclerotic. It won't move up so easily. So that's why the wires, and that's why the very gradual, very slow, it took 3 months to lift it up very, very slowly. So
Milind, was that an attempted osteotomy, that same patient?
It was a clear dome osteotomy below it. It's about an inch below that. We did the osteotomy.
No.
Sorry.
No. The primary problem.
Why did the non-union occur?
It was not a. It's
a fracture.
It's a fracture non-union.
Fracture non-union. It's not an HTO. No. It's a fracture non-union.
Fracture shaft femur post major crush injuries with muscle loss.
Yeah.
Ilizarov, how much good result it can give? Muscle loss is also there with
Got
fracture
it.
Shaft femur.
Got it.
And infections.
Got it.
Ilizarov, how are the results which you might have experienced are?
Right, sir. So what you can do is follow similar principles because I presume you have muscle loss over the site of the non-union. So you don't fix that zone immediately. You span it. You go across it like a long bridging plate or something. And when you have done something to get a good coverage, then you can. And then despite the muscle loss, they will heal if you've gotten rid of all the dead bone. You can't leave the dead bone inside. You have to not get scared about resecting dead bone. With Ilizarov, that's one advantage. So, and make them walk. So,
Milind, you rightly said that these distal tibia and proximal tibia with MIPPO do badly.
Could do.
One reason you said is diabetic.
Yes, sir.
So therefore, the peripheral circulation is bad.
Yes, sir.
If you take an X-ray of the leg and if you take the X-ray of the femur, you might see that there is a calcification of the femoral artery, the dorsalis pedis artery, and the posterior tibial artery,
correct,
which I had in one case. So the thing to do that is not to fix this MIPPO straight away.
Right.
I would say that I would put a fixator till the wrinkling sign comes.
Correct.
And secondly, no tourniquet. Absolutely no tourniquet.
Okay.
And wait, put the fixator. Don't worry if the patient goes to somebody else, nothing will happen. Just put the fixator, wait for the wrinkling sign, and no tourniquet.
Okay.
And these will do better than getting a total necrosis of the distal tibia and proximal tibia fractures.
Yeah. That makes sense.
Hemant.
That's new. That's new.
Milind, faced with the situation, there is a gap, non-union, between the tibial tuberosity and the tibial condyle, a gap of about 1.5 inch with intact fibula. Now, I was considering whether any bone transport would have been possible because it would have altered the biomechanics of the knee with, you know, maybe a patella alta or something would have happened. Gap non-union between the tibial tuberosity and the tibial condyle.
So there's a proximal tibial fragment with the tuberosity with it and the distal tibia, and there's a gap between the two of them.
Yeah, the tibial tuberosity is with the distal fragment,
I see.
And tibial condyle is separate, and there's a gap of about 1.5 inch.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
A very intact fibula.
Yes. Yes.
Any,
so
what solution or anything?
Yes. So if you can even fix the proximal condylar area with even a couple of wires, three wires, and then you augment the fixation with a temporary femoral fixation, and then you do a side to side, you get the distal fragment coming up like this. I mean, the distal fragment has the tuberosity, so you have it coming down. So you set up the washers, the systems with the hinges, make sure that all the anteromedial, posteromedial, anterolateral, posterolateral hinges are perfectly parallel. If they're like this and like this, it's not going to work. They have to be parallel. And then just set it up with washers so that the distal fragment comes down and you have a side-to-side compression.
But then will that change the relationship between the knee joint and the tuberosity? It will come closer. So I think what he's trying to ask is, where would you consider putting in a graft, a bone graft?
Okay, so if your skin condition and other things permit you to use a bone grafting, and I thought you said that the tuberosity and the distal fragment are shifted away. There is a gap, meaning it's a longitudinal gap or it's a...
Longitudinal.
Okay. Okay, so if you can graft it and then fix it, if your skin is good, then that could solve it. You may need not do the Ilizarov, I suppose. So you could do side-to-side compression if it's not going to change, like Mangal said, the orientation of the, you know, the patellofemoral mechanics. If you can do that, that should work.
So what he's saying is, if your skin is okay, then you can consider. But if your skin is not okay, then probably you need to do a staged procedure. And you can use the Ilizarov as a good fixation option for a small proximal segment, because you can shoot in multiple wires through that in various directions. So you can mix up conventional and Ilizarov.
Yes, definitely.
Nowadays, in all these trauma meetings, we talk about the masculine technique.
In trauma meetings, you don't have Ilizarov at all.
I understand, Milind.
By the way.
But I understand. But masculine technique in gap non-unions infected, I want to ask you, the bone which has formed, I don't know if you do it or not, but the bone which has formed in the masculine technique or after the bone grafting, masculine is generally done over the nail. Have you compared the quality of the bone formed in the bone grafting after masculine and the quality of bone in your Ilizarovs after lengthening and after compression in an infected? No, the thing is that...
Don't get me started.
No. I commit to you that it is the Ilizarov which is better probably in the quality of bone. The patient cannot walk on the bone quality which is formed in after masculine.
Okay, so you opened the Pandora's box.
Yes, exactly.
All of you thought that masculine is your answer to the Ilizarov guys. Sala, shut up you guys, we've got our masculine now. Huh?
Yeah, but no, it is not true. It is not true.
Masculine with Ilizarov.
What is your experience?
Sir, every masculine in my hands has failed.
Yeah.
Every. Okay. In the femur, in the tibia, it has failed. I'm sure I may be not doing it right.
I'll tell you.
Number one, in the tibia, there is very poor soft tissue cover. Even Dr. G.S. Kulkarni agrees that it doesn't work too well in the tibia. He says it works in the femur. I have tried it in the... I'll tell you this. See, first of all, you need a lot of graft. See, remember one thing. Bone transport has been done in the tens of thousands, in the scores of thousands, that's 20s of thousands all over the world. Now, for about the last 60, 70 years, number one. The technique is adopted everywhere. It is not physiologically expensive. See, what you do is you go away from the site of the trauma, you do a percutaneous corticotomy. Even if you've got a horrendous infected non-union in the lower end of the femur with very poor everything over there, if you go above and do a corticotomy, at minimum physiological cost to the patient, the bone starts forming and it's easy to transport it down. The bone always forms. I recently analyzed 100 post-traumatic lengthenings in the proximal femur done by us. We've got 28% premature consolidation. There's so much good bone forming, regardless of how bad the lower end site is. So bone transport never fails. And it's physiologically cheap. It's inexpensive to the physiology of the patient. When you do a masculine, you need to harvest huge quantum of graft. Either you do that by RIA method, which is physiologically very expensive. You put in the RIA reamer, the RIA reamer, and within 30, 40 seconds, you lost 400 ml, 500 ml of blood just to get that 60, 80 cc's of graft. And if there's a bit of infection, that graft grows, poof, it vanishes in front of your eyes. And the quality of the bone, like you said, leaves much to be desired. Even mascale with Ilizarov, sir, all of them were combined with Ilizarov. And I rued the day I tried it, because in my hands, I may be doing something wrong. I agree.
No, I think...
I agree.
But they don't remove the nail. The patient walks on the nail, probably.
Yes. I agree.
Well, there are good results with the masculae, but they are mainly in, first of all, masculae's hands. But if you look at masculae's original article, I think it was 31 cases which had this thing done. All of them, not all of them, sorry, I think about 28 of them had a soft tissue procedure. So you need good soft tissue before you do a masculae. Yeah. Two, as part of the procedure, at a second stage, they flip the patient over and do a tibia pro fibula. Nobody, if you have not read the original article, you don't know this.
Man.
So tibia pro fibula is part of the masculae procedure. And most of the other authors have found that on the tibia, it is not as reliable. So if you want one reliable procedure which will get you a good quality of bone, it is Ilizarov.
Fair enough.
Milind, this small fragment of the tibia, posterior medial fragment, that was a fresh case or non-union that came to you?
With the policeman or the elderly person with
police,
the cox?
Police fella.
It's about, I think, nine months after trauma, post-trauma non-union.
But was he treated? No.
With a plate, yes. It's infected, sclerotic, poor skin. He had a plate that failed.
Okay. Because all that we didn't see, that's right.
Yeah, sorry. Don't have the X-rays are not with me. The
Last question. Yeah.
So, when do you decide to bone graft in an infected non-union? And second, what have been your results? Means how many of them do get infected and get resolved?
Okay, it's a good question. Do you bone graft in an infected non-union? So first, let me go step by step. The first task is to take care of the infection. Get rid of the infection. So I'm not combining the Ilizarov with the treatment of the infection in the first stage. I'm always doing a staged treatment. In the first stage, we do a thorough debridement. Our task is only to get rid of the infection. We debride. We put in cement rods or beads or whatever. We do cultures, we give antibiotics. We don't mess up, we don't mix the two things. Then at the end of 6 weeks, when his parameters have come back to normal, his skin looks good, he looks like he's healthier, he's in positive nitrogen balance, then we put on the Ilizarov and we do the compression and the other things. If we do a corticotomy and the patient starts walking with the fixator, everything improves. So actually we've published in the Journal of Limb Lengthening Reconstruction, even lower end infected non-unions of the TBR, 37 of them, not a single one needed a bone graft. So if you do this side-to-side compression, if you do the right compression, if they are able to walk and you've gotten rid of the infection, you may not need a bone grafting. But if you do need a grafting at the end of, say, 3, 4, 5 months, you see nothing is happening. By that stage, the infection is completely taken care of. So you can add some graft and get away with it.
Even if you have grafted and the graft gets infected, then what do you do next?
So then you have to resort to the basic techniques which I have tried to highlight. That is good compression, either longitudinal or side to side. Get the patient to walk, have stability, cross the joints, do the simple things right. So, bone graft is not the only thing.
So, short answer is he never grafts an infected non-union. He creates, he changes it from infected to non-infected and only then grafts it if required, right? Thank you, Milind.
Thank you.